Is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
And
yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And I hope I'm audible to all of you.
Yes, ma'am.
Clearly audible, isn't it? Hello, clearly audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, okay, okay. So today we'll discuss first we'll discuss about the conductors and cables. Okay, what are the different types of conductors that we use both for domestic purpose and transmission and distribution purposes? And then we'll discuss the concept of earthing. You must have heard the term earthing. And then we'll discuss the different aspects or different rules and regulations for different types of distribution voltages. That means for low voltage distribution, for medium voltage distribution, and for high voltage distribution. So conductors and cables. Okay. So we know the conductors, that they carry the current. Now, for safety in handling, we know the conductors have to be insulated, okay? But for transmission purposes, mainly we use bare conductors. But for distribution purpose, the conductors must be insulated. And you have heard the name VIR cable or conductor, PVC cable or conductor, like that. What are those? Actually, those are the insulations, okay? VIR cable means vulcanized India rubber, polyvinyl chloride. PVC means polyvinyl chloride type of insulation. And what is cable? What is the difference between conductor and cable? See, when one or more of insulated wires are bundled together within another insulated outer covering, it becomes a cable. Okay, so a cable actually consists of more than one insulated conductors. They are bunched together or bundled together inside an overall insulator, and that is known as cable. Okay. And some simple things that you know already: conductors must be good, must be made of good conducting material, and the best material, conducting material, is silver. But as it is very expensive, so silver is rarely used except for some special purposes. Okay, so other than silver, the next best material is copper. Okay, so these are the resistivity of silver and copper given. Both are in ohm centimeter. You should mention the unit always, though here the unit is not mentioned. So you know the best material is silver. And then copper is used. And in our country, as we have abundant storage of bauxite, aluminium conductors are used. Okay. So a comparison between silver, copper, and aluminium, if you prepare a comparison, both the advantages and disadvantages, some of them are given here. Aluminium, why it is advantageous? Because of its lightweight. Of course, its resistivity is higher than that of copper, and the resistivity of copper is higher than that of the silver. Okay, so, and copper is not affected by weather conditions, whereas aluminium is affected by weather conditions. So these are some simple things that you go through this notes, or you go through some other materials. So this you can easily understand if you go through them. Okay, so I will not discuss. Actually, I will not explain anything. These are very simple things. I will only discuss what are the things you need to study. Okay. So then the different types of conductors or different types of cables. The cables may be classified on the basis of the insulation. Okay, what type of insulation is provided, based on that the cables can be classified. So VIR cables, lead cover VIR cables. So a short description of all these are given. So you go through them. Tough sheathed rubber cable, tough rubber sheath cable, PVC cable, flexible cables. Okay, so two or three sentences about each type of cable is given here. You please go through them. Now comes the stranded conductors. You must have heard the name stranded conductors. Okay. Let me see if anybody is trying to. Okay. So, the stranded conductors. You must have heard the name stranded conductor. What are stranded conductors? Let's see the picture of stranded conductors. Say, this is a solid conductor and this is stranded conductor. So, stranded conductors are actually a bunch of conductors, very conductors, thin conductors. That means conductors of very small diameters without insulation. Okay. So no insulation is there in these conductors, but whole of the total number of the whole conductors, these conductors are bunched together inside a single insulation. Okay. So these are the stranded conductors. So what are the advantages of stranded conductors? So stranded conductor consists of several thin wires of small cross-sectional areas. Okay. The basic reason for using stranded conductors is to make the conductor flexible. Okay. If we use a single solid conductor, it becomes difficult to transport power because it does not have sufficient flexibility. Okay, and it is difficult to coil a solid conductor. So the flexibility is more in case of stranded conductors, as they can be coiled easily to transport power over long distances. Now some important things about the stranded conductors. I told you they are a very small cross-sectional area and have sufficient flexibility than a single core conductor. So stranded conductor is formed by twisting the strands together in layers. You have seen the stranded conductors in the machine laboratory. You have performed experiments mainly taking the stranded conductors. These stranded conductors are twisted one over the other. You have seen, okay, very thin cross-sectional area. So the strands of each layer are laid in helical fashion over the preceding layer. This process is called stranding. The stranding is done opposite to the preceding layer. Okay, this means if one layer are twisted in clockwise direction, the strands of the next layer will be twisted in the anti-clockwise direction. And of course, you can understand the resistance of the stranded conductors are greater than that of a solid conductor of the same diameter. Okay, how to find the diameter of the conductor? The diameter, overall diameter of the stranded conductor is 2x minus 1 into d, where d is the diameter of each strand. Okay, and x is the number of layers in the conductor. So the advantages are increased flexibility, increased mechanical strength, and it also helps to reduce skin effect and inductance. Okay. Now, say it is given 19 by 0.64 cable or stranded conductor. What does this mean? This means that 19 is the number of strands. Simply, it will be given, say, 19 by 0.64 PVC cable. What is understood by this? This means if it is given PVC cable, then you can understand that the outer insulation is made of polyvinyl chloride. Only this insulation is made of polyvinyl chloride. There is no insulation provided to the individual conductors. Okay. So, and 19 is the number of strands, and each strand is having a diameter of 0.64 millimeter. So sometimes you will be given this term and you will be asked to write down the meaning of this conductor. Okay. Also, you will find that this is shown in the first slide like this, 23 by 0.3 PVC cable. Okay. So this is all about stranded conductors. Now we have classified the conductors based on the type of insulation provided. Now the classification dependent upon the material of the conductor or internal structure of the conductors. Though the photocopy is not very clear, but I don't think you'll be having some problem, any problem. First one is hard-drawn copper conductors. Hard-drawn means copper conductor, some other materials of, or some other elements are added to the copper conductor, okay, to increase the mechanical strength. Very small percentage, maybe 0.5% only. That means copper will consist of 99.5 and 0.5 of some other material. So hard drawn copper conductors. So you read from this one. This table you need not remember, but you can get some idea about hard drawn aluminum and hard drawn copper. Concept is same. In hard drawn aluminum also a small percentage of other material is mixed. Then cadmium copper conductor. So it consists of two types of material elements. One is cadmium, another is copper. So advantages are given. The property of higher tensile strength enables it to be erected on longer spans with higher tensile. The sentence is wrong. Same is repeated. Anyway, the hard drawn, like hard drawn copper, this alloy, it is an alloy because two elements are there, cadmium and copper. It has some advantages. The advantages are written here: more resistance to atmospheric corrosion, better resistance to wear, easy machinability, like that. Okay, so you go through these, all these advantages and disadvantages. I will not discuss them. Then you have steel coat copper conductor. That means here the internal part, okay, or the center part is made of steel, okay, but conductors are placed in the outer part. They are made of copper, okay. You will understand this steel coat copper just after some time. I will these types of conductors are very often used. The coat is made of some material which are not the conductors, because you know in skin effect what happens, the central part, it, because it is AC, the central part does not carry any current. The currents are concentrated on the outer periphery. So it will hardly matter what type of material we use at the center part. But why do we use steel at the center part? To provide the mechanical strength. Maybe if we use only copper, only aluminum, sufficient mechanical strength is not reached. So we use steel core, and the conductor material is the copper conductor. And then copper weld conductor. Copper is welded on a steel wire by hot rolling, and this is called copper weld conductor. Okay. And then we have hard drawn aluminum conductor. Just we had hard drawn copper conductors. Here we have hard drawn aluminum conductors. Now the most important one is the aluminum conductor. Steel reinforced. It is very commonly used, and it is abbreviated as ACSR. Now, can you hear me properly?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. ACSR conductor. Okay. See, aluminum. It is not aluminum core steel reinforced. Very often we ask students questions, what is ACSR? They answer, many of them answer aluminum core steel reinforced. No, the core is steel. And see, you see the figure, then it will be clear to you. See, this is the figure. The central part is consists of strands of steel. Why steel is given? Because just to increase the mechanical strength, okay? And the outer part consists of aluminum. So aluminum is the conductor. We can neglect the resistance of, while calculating the total resistance of this conductor, we can neglect the resistance of the steel part because it will not carry any current, very negligible current. So most of the currents will be concentrated on the outer periphery due to skin effect, and we'll consider the aluminum resistance of the aluminum while finding the resistance of the overall conductor. Okay, so inside part is steel, so it is called aluminum conductor steel reinforced. Okay, conductors are made of all aluminum. This is only a pure aluminum. Okay, this is made of pure aluminum, but here, what is the disadvantage of all aluminum is, if we don't use the steel core, then what will happen? They are not strong enough for construction of long span lines. Okay, that's why we use this type of conductor. This is called aluminum conductor steel reinforced, or it is also called steel cored aluminum, SCA. Okay, because the core is steel. Okay, so here, what is there? Here, how many strands of steel are there? This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 strands of steel are there. Okay, So 7 steel strands form the central core around which we use 2 layers of 30 aluminum strands. If we just count them, it will be 30. It may be more, maybe less, okay. For a given resistance, conductor of different strengths can be made by taking different proportions of steel and aluminum areas. Only the conductivity of aluminum conductor is taken for calculating the current carrying capacity and the resistance. So the current carrying capacity of the conductor is determined solely by the number of strands of the aluminum. Okay. So what are the important advantages of ACSR conductors? The advantages are given here. Disadvantages are given here. You carefully go through it, okay? Because this is the most commonly used type of conductor. Now, smooth body ACSR conductor. Actually, here it is not smooth, you can see. So in the smooth body or compacted ACSR, the ACSR, this type of conductors is pressed through dies to flatten the aluminum strands into segmental shape. If you see the figure, you will understand. It is a smooth body or compacted ACSR conductor. Okay, this is the normal ACSR conductor just we discussed. And this is the smooth, compacted or smooth body ACSR. So we find the advantages and disadvantages. Now, this is expanded ACSR. What is expanded? You can see the core area is expanded by filling up this internal part, or the space is created between the core, steel core and the aluminum conductors, and this part is filled with some plastic or fibrous material, okay, to make the diameter of conductor large. Okay, why the diameter of conductor is made large? To reduce corona loss and radio interference. Okay, if the conductor diameter is large, the corona loss is reduced. So here, this is just like this is just ACSR conductor, only that inner core area has been expanded. Next, all aluminium alloy conductor. Here some alloy is mixed. So what are the different types of alloy? You go through them. And then say 0.5% silicon, 0.5% magnesium, and the remainder is aluminium. So 99% aluminium and very small percentage of magnesium and aluminium. ACSR conductor, aluminium conductor alloy reinforced. Instead of steel reinforced ACSR, it is alloy reinforced. Sometimes some other alloys are used to as the core material. Then aluminium powder is welded, okay, here. So the name alumo weld. And then phosphor bronze conductor. Phosphor bronze is used as a conductor material for very long spans such as river crossings, okay. It has low conductivity, but for very specific purposes it is used. It is more stronger than copper conductor. So here the strength mainly matters, and where the strength mainly matters, we use phosphor bronze conductor. Similarly, another conductor can be galvanized steel conductor. Galvanized steel conductors are used where high strength is required. They are used on very long spans, okay. And so you just have an overview of all the types of conductors. You go through these notes, you will find, and of course you will find some of them in books, and also you can search internets to find their specific applications. Okay, I hope this up to this it is clear.
Yes ma'am.
Yes ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Now next we'll come to filament lamps, because you have some lamps in your syllabus, though I don't have material today for LED lamps. We can discuss later on, or I can provide you some notes, because nowadays LED lamps is what happened. 1 minute. Okay. Then filament lamps. Now, filament lab, you know, nowadays their uses have become very rare. Filament lamps means that is a tungsten filament, and when it is heated, it glows and emits light. Okay, so generally the vacuum types of bulbs are used to avoid heat loss from the filament, but it causes evaporation of the filament. Therefore, sometimes some inert gases are introduced. Okay, so it is very simple. You go through it. So the and sometimes the coil is the filament is coiled to reduce the effective area of cooling. Okay, so it is very simple. You go through. You all of you have idea about the filament lamps. Now the fluorescent lamp. Also, I think you are in second year, so you must have performed experiment at fluorescent lamp in the first year. So fluorescent lamp, you know the structure of fluorescent lamp. It consists of a glass tube. The length varies, with interior coated with fluorescent powder such as magnesium tungsten. Okay. The glass tube consists of mercury vapor and argon gas at low temperature. And electrodes are provided at both the ends. Okay. When the lamp functions, the electrodes are heated and the electrons emitted by them excite the mercury atoms to produce ultraviolet rays. So actually, this lamp functions when the electrodes at the both ends of the tube, they are heated and they emit electrons. What will happen when they emit electrons? Those electrons, they excite the mercury atoms, because the gas tube is filled with mercury vapor and it is coated with magnesium tungsten. Okay, and these vapors, they react with the fluorescent material to emit light. Okay, the fluorescent material is phosphor, and depending upon the types of the material, different colors can be emitted. You go through it, and I will mainly discuss because you should know the operating principle of the fluorescent lamp. See, this is the structure of fluorescent lamp. Okay, you have seen the structure while performing the experiment in the laboratory. So what it consists of? One choke and another starter. Okay, this one is capacitor. It is used to suppress the arcing. Okay, arcing means when the medium inside the starter, it glows. Okay, and C2, this is used for power factor improvement. This is the switch where the supply is given. So suppose when the supply is given, the circuit is like this. This is the choke. It will go through these electrodes, but here, unless the electrodes they create or eliminate emit electrons, and this will not glow. Okay. So what happens? First, let us see the structure of this starter. In starter, there are two bimetallic strips, okay, which are normally open. And this is inside a glass envelope that is filled with helium gas. So when it is switched on, the power is given to the starters, but the starter, they are open. Okay, the strips are open, so current cannot pass through it. So the starter, the two metal strips, they get heated, okay, when the supply is given. Now when they get heated, they expand and they close the contacts. Okay, so when the supply is given, initially these are open, and when they get heated, they close their contacts. Now as soon as they close their contacts, so current will start flowing. So initially the current will have the path from here to here, not through the lamp, but through here. Again, they will return through the electrodes to this one. But when current starts flowing, the helium gas that is present, they have a cooling effect. They have a cooling effect. And what happens? It cools the starter, it cools the bimetallic strip, and again the contacts are open. Okay. So when the contacts, the bimetallic strips cool down and suddenly open the contacts. So if the contacts open, suddenly there is a break in current. So what will happen? The rate of change of current is DIDT. So what is the voltage developed by the choke? It is LDIDT. This DIDT is very large, and so the voltage developed by the choke is very large. that large voltage, they actually cause an arc to strike between the electrodes. Okay, you have heard the name arc while studying the circuit breaker. This is same as here. Okay, so that high voltage that will make the emission of these electrons from the electrodes. Once arc is struck, a high voltage is not necessary to maintain. So arc is struck means the glow will appear within this glass tube on the principle that we discussed here. Okay, because the electrons will be emitted, they will excite the mercury atoms to produce ultraviolet rays which impinge on the fluorescent material or phosphor, causing it to emit light. So for the emission of the electrons, this starter and choke, they have their functions. Okay, now once the arc is struck, no need of there is no requirement of such high voltage. Okay, so the high voltage is required only to start the lamp or start the glowing of the lamp. We have seen in the laboratory. So once the arc is struck, a high voltage is not necessary to maintain it. Well, now what happens? This remains open. Okay, because now the path is through the electrodes, through the glass tube, and again it will come back to the supply. Okay, the starter has no purpose. Only during the starting is this required. Now, the starter contacts remain open. The choke then regulates the lamp current only, because the current flows through the choke. Okay, continuous current flows through the choke, so it regulates the current. Now, nowadays, instead of this choke, okay, what we use, what is written here, let us see. These lamps are not used for frequent starting, because why? Because the constant impact of the electrons on the electrodes during normal operation dislodges some of the emitting material. Okay, finally, so little of the material remains that it is not possible for the electrodes to emit more electrons. Okay, so then the tube cannot be lit up, because the electrodes are emitting electrons, therefore the lamp is glowing. Now, glow type starter does not work satisfactorily when the supply voltage is low and may take several seconds for the lamp to lit up. So we use electronic ballast, okay, nowadays. So electronic ballast, the principle is completely different here. It employs a transistor capacitor combination to convert the low input supply frequency, okay, supply frequency is only 50 hertz, to a high frequency while also regulating the current through the lamp. Okay, so use of this electronic ballast, it helps to raise the efficiency of the lamps. Now, the other advantages of this fluorescent lamp is written here. And this compact fluorescent lamp is just advanced version of this fluorescent lamp. It is very commonly used. You have seen this type of lamp. These are already the name it indicates. It is in compact form, and both the electronic ballast, is kept in this holder only. Okay, so very small area is required for this one, or small volume is required. And the use of ballast inside the lamp holder. Okay, that ballast is kept inside the lamp holder, and some things are written here. The CFLs have two main components, a glass tube and the electronic ballast. The ballast consists of small circuit board with a rectifier, filter capacitor, and switching transistors. Okay, so high frequency is generated by this transistor, and the emission, the principle of emission of the or glowing of the lamp is same as that of the previous one. Now, the merits and demerits of the fluorescent lamp or compact fluorescent lamps are given here. Now, these are very general things. I have managed one notes. It is not that you should study from here only. You try to find some good books, or from the internet also you can get lots of materials on this, or the current development on these materials, that also you can study. Okay. I hope you can hear me properly.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Now, next topic is earthing. What do you mean by earthing? Earthing means actually a very low resistance conductive connection. You know, earthing is mainly provided for safety purpose. Okay, so that if there is any loss of insulation or if there is any leakage in insulating material, the persons or the personnel, they do not get any shock. Okay, and even if there is some fault, that current can pass to the ground through this earth resistance. Okay, so actually the purpose of earth resistance, primary objective of earthing electrical equipment, is to save person from shock in the event of any weakening or failure of insulation. Also, it also protects the apparatus and personnel from high voltage surges and lightning discharge. Okay, so in your, you know, a three pin socket. Okay, in three pin socket, the left one is the live conductor, right one is the neutral conductor, and the upper one of larger cross section is the earth conductor. Okay, so earthing means a low resistance conductive connection of the metallic bodies of electrical equipment, which are not ordinarily supposed to carry currents. Okay, you know, in a conductor, it is the conductors in your house for domestic purpose, they are insulated. So if you touch the insulation, you should not get any shock. But if some, there is some leakage in the insulation, what will happen? If it is earth, then no problem. The leakage current will pass, so the leakage charge will pass through the earth conductor. But if it is not properly earth, then the person touching that insulating part will get a shock. Similarly, the metallic bodies of the electrical equipment, normally we should not get shock if we touch the metallic part, even when it is under operation. But what happens if there is any leakage or like that, then the personnel may get shock if those metallic bodies are not properly earthed. Okay. So earthing means a low resistance conductive connection of metallic bodies of electrical equipment which are not ordinarily supposed to carry currents to the general mass of the earth through earth electrode. Now this earth, what is earth electrode, that you will, I will discuss just after a few moments. See, the earth resistance depends upon material of electrode and earthware. So these electrodes are buried inside the soil, okay? And a wear actually comes out from there, that is called the earthware. And this earthware, actually earthing is done for our low voltage installation. Earthing is done at the substation or at the generator premises, okay? And the earthware is provided. The size of electrode and earthware, moisture content of the soil, temperature of the soil, depth to which the electrode has been embedded, because I told you they are embedded deep inside the soil. Then quantity of charcoal and salt in the earth pit. So earth pit means where the electrodes are embedded. Okay, they are actually, let me show you the figure. You have two types of C. This is called the earth pit. Okay, salt and charcoal, these are put in alternate layers and it is frequently watered so that it remains under moist condition. Okay, so now, okay, quantity of charcoal and salt in the earth pit, the maximum permissible value of earth electrode resistance is 5 ohms. So maximum earth resistance should be 5 ohms, but for good performance, it should not exceed 1 ohm or 0.5 ohm. Okay, 0.5 ohm at powerhouse and 1 ohm at substation. The primary of, I told you that these are sufficient for low voltage domestic purposes. Low voltage means 230 or 450, three phase three wire supply. The primary objective I told you I discussed. Now Every supply company should provide and maintain an efficient earthing of their own near the point of commencement of their supply at the consumer premises. Okay, every supply company should provide the earthing. Actually, earthing where is provided? A domestic consumer need not provide his own earthing with a separate earth electrode. They need not create the earthing facility, but medium and high voltage consumers must provide their own earth with independent earth electrode. Okay, for high voltage domestic purposes, this earthing is separate earthing must be done at the consumer premises. Now, these two earths to us means one provided by the supply company and another provided by the consumers. They should operate in parallel. Now, earth pit should be located at a place where soil has sufficient chance of remaining wet and no chance of being affected by excavation work. Okay, because those are permanently embedded, so they should not be disturbed by excavation work. Therefore, earth pit should never. Earth pit means where the electrodes are embedded. This is called actually the earth pit. Okay, so these are. Therefore, earth pit should never be located near roadways. But besides such, earth pit must be at least 1.5 meter away from buildings to ensure low earth resistance. Now, the earth where from the earth electrode up to the supply company's cutout is called main earthing lead. Okay. Main earthing lead will come from this electrode. The earth where that is coming out from this one is called earthing lead. Okay, actually we do not see the earthing. We get only the earthing lead. Okay, it's called the main earthing lead. This must be a copper wire for copper plate earthing and a GI wire for GI plate earthing. Two types of earthing are there. You will find one is GI plate earthing, another is copper earthing. Okay. So for copper earthing, copper wire is required. For GI earthing, GI wire is required. This earth wire should be mechanically protected by a 19.5 millimeter diameter GI pipe. These measurements are very specific. So it is not that only the lead is coming out. It should be protected within a GI pipe of this millimeter diameter after emerge within the soil. After emerging from the soil, this pipe should be fitted to floors and walls. All nuts and bolts must be made of the same material as that of pipe or plate. Okay. Now, the earth electrode, I have told you, should be surrounded by alternate layers of charcoal and salt. Frequent watering of the earth near the earth electrode or plate is necessary to maintain a low resistance, even in summer. For such watering of the earth, the GI pipe of 19.5 millimeter diameter fitted with a funnel at the top is run up to the pipe or plate end. This GI pipe is only for watering the earth pit. Now, mainly there are two types of earthing, and these specifications you have to remember. Okay, this millimeter, what is the diameter, what is the length? Length is 2 meters. Sometimes it can be 2.75 meters for pipe earthing, and for plate earthing, what is the size of plate? That you have to remember. Okay, and the figure are given for pipe earthing and for plate earthing. You can find some other figures in some other books also. You can study from there. Okay, so just some important and salient points about earthing. Clear? Is it clear to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this part is over. Then now I will come to some technical aspects of power planning. That is, I will give a very short overview on the three types of connections: low tension connection, medium tension, and high tension connection, domestic connection. Okay, not the transmission, domestic system, a distribution system, and the domestic system for domestic purposes. Okay, the points are given here. You go through it. These are written in very simple languages. Okay, So you need not, you will not find any difficulty in understanding what is written. Okay. So low tension service main connection, generally it is 230 volts, we say that it is low tension, and maximum it can be up to 650. Okay. For this type of connection, there are some rules. How many rules are given? 10 rules are actually given. Okay. And what is rule number one? First rule is that power and heating subcircuits should be separate, okay, from the lighting and fan subcircuits. Okay. Power and heating means microwave, geyser, and some other, for other purposes, those subcircuits and lighting fan subcircuits should be different. Okay. Not from the same circuit, they should be provided. The conductors are made of copper and aluminium, and the cross-sectional area of that copper and aluminium are given here. For the sub-circuit wiring means for this lighting and fan wiring, these are the cross-sectional areas, and for heating and power sub-circuits, these are called power wiring. Okay, for power wiring, they should be of larger cross-sectional area. This is given here. The size of conductors should be selected in such a way that at no point in the house or installation, the voltage drop is more than 3%. Okay, say where the power is entering in the house, the voltage that you are supposed to get there, and at any remote corner of the house, the voltage drop should not be more than 3%. Okay, this is a regulation. This should be kept in mind while designing any sub-circuit or circuit inside the house. So, the current rating of the cable should be more than that of the fuse. If it is less than the fuse, what will happen? The fuse will never blow out. Okay. So if the current exceeds the safety limit, then the fuse should first blow out. Okay, so the current rating of cable should not be less than that of fuse. It should be more than that of the fuse. You know, fuse is always provided in the live conductor. It should not never be provided in the neutral conductor. Main distribution board shall proceed. Actually, it should be written, shall be preceded with a switch on each pole of the circuit. Okay. There should be a switch. You will find the distribution board. Actually, you see the figure. This is the figure. This is the main distribution board. Say, in a multi-storied building, this main distribution board is located at the ground floor level. And from there, different sub-distribution boards are taken, the wires are taken, and different sub-distribution boards, these may be located at different floors. Okay, so each distribution board should be provided by its own switch. Okay, and a fuse on the live conductor, and branch and sub-distribution boards shall be provided with a fuse. Same thing is written. The earth neutral conductors, neutral conductor is earth, shall be connected to a common link. Light and fans should be wired on a common link. Such sub-circuit should not have more than a total of 10 points of outlets. Each sub-circuit can be maximum, can have 10 points of outlets, not more than that. Okay. See, here you go directly go to this figure. This is actually the structure. How, see, in your domestic purpose, see, this is the earthing provided at the supply authority. EPSM is earthing of the power supply authority. Okay. And this is supply company's cutout. Actually, the supply company will provide you this one. One live conductor and another neutral conductor. And first, these will end. This is called supply company's cutout. Okay. Two wires will be there, and they will terminate at the energy meter. Okay. After energy meter, then it comes to the consumer main switch. So actually, up to energy meter, it is the supply authority's premises. Okay. You don't have any right over this portion. Your premises will start, your means consumers liability will start from this consumer main switch. Okay, so it is written here, the property of the consumer begins from his main switch. Okay, you cannot disturb this anything up to this energy meter. So this is the consumer main switch, and this is the main distribution box. From here, this is called the main circuit, and these are called sub main circuit, and these are called sub distribution box. Okay, so whatever I have told you, this is written here. And last point, all outlet points in different sub circuits should be connected through a single pole switch placed in the live wire. So switch should be placed in the live wire. Switches may be after these are ratings, you know, 15. Nowadays, Tumblr type of switch is not used. 15 ampere or 5 ampere. Okay. Now this is all about the main sub main or main distribution main wiring sub circuit wiring and all those things, and some very few sentences about the sub circuit wiring. Sub circuit wiring are of three types. Sub circuit wiring means this wiring that comes from the sub distribution boxes. So these are given, one is tree system, the figure is given, another radiating loop system, another is radiating junction box. Actually, radiating loop system, junction box are same, only the junction is made. Here the circuit wiring is made inside a junction box. So you go through this, you will easily understand. Now next one is the medium tension service main connection. I hope I am audible. Again, I am asking you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Now, medium tension means it is 415 volts, 3-phase, 4-wire, 50 hertz, or 440 volts, 3-wire DC. Okay? Because the distribution system can also be DC, though we use AC. Now, whatever things I've discussed for low tension wiring, that should be maintained for both medium and high tension wiring. So, what the other restrictions for this medium tension wiring are given here. Okay, so what is the main thing? The main thing is that the system shall be earthed by not less than two separate and distinct connections with earth, both that the generating station and the substation of consumer premises. Okay, two separate earthings should be provided, one at the generating station and another at the substation of the consumer premises. Now the frame of every generator, because you know motors, they generally run, they require 415 volt supply. So the frame of every generator, stationary motor and all these things, and the metallic parts of transformers shall be earthed by consumer by two separate and distinct connections with the earth. So these should be, the metallic parts of every machine should be connected to the earth. Okay, then what are the other things given? These you can I think you can easily understand these things if you study, you can easily understand. The supply of energy to each motor or other apparatus is controlled by suitable link switch or a circuit breaker of requisite capacity placed in an adjacent position of the motor. Sometimes circuit breakers are required. And all medium tension lines should be preferably run through metallic arc conduits. The conductor should be bunched. Conduits means actually the conductors are bunched together in a single conduit. Okay. Such that the induction heating is prevented as far as possible. For multi-storied building, each floor should have its own main distribution box preceded by its own consumer switch. Okay, so for medium tension, each floor should have separate main distribution board. Okay. Now for high tension service main, now for high tension, actually for medium and low tension not much accessories are required, but for high tension service main connection exceeding 650 volts some special arrangement should be made. Though those arrangement, they entails a large cost, but there are some advantages of using high tension service main connection. Those advantages are given here, But the some special considerations that should be followed for high tension connection are written here. Separate switch room shall be provided. This is very important. It may be outside, or if it is not possible, it may be inside. But the main substation and switch room preferably should be located outside the main building or in the open air, provided the equipment is designed for outdoor use and adequately protected against contact by unauthorized persons. Sometimes it is not possible. So in that case, it is indoor. But the main substation should be preferably be located on the lowest floor level. Okay, in the ground floor level, an adequate means of direct access from the street for installation and removal of equipment shall be provided. The floor level of the substation or switch room should be above the highest flood level of the locality. This is obvious because the switch room, it will contain many accessories, okay, protective equipment and all those things. Now, some other things. Additional substations that may be required in case of internal distribution at high voltage shall be situated as closely as practicable to the load center for which it caters. It will be placed at the center of the load. For high-rise buildings, it is desired to install a substation. If it is desired, if it is not possible to install the substation at the lower level, ground level, if it is, it has to be installed in the upper level. Dry type transformers or transformers cooled by non-inflammable liquid shall be used. Okay, so it must contain a transformer, the switch room. Transformer and switch gears having oil content exceeding 2000 liters in one chamber shall be segregated from one another and from high and medium voltage switchboards by fire resistors, resisting barriers. Okay. And equipment installed in a substation shall be solidly earthed. The neutral point of the transformer winding and the earthing lead of the medium voltage installation shall also be connected to the earth electrode. Okay, these are the considerations that you have to follow for high tension service connection. Now, some protection of HT mains. You know, if for protection of this high tension lines, both circuit breakers and fuses are provided. Okay, so when circuit breakers are used for protection of a main circuit and sub-circuits derived therefrom, discrimination in operation may be achieved by adjusting protecting devices of sub-main circuit breakers to operate at lower current settings and shorter time lag than the main circuit breaker. Suppose the circuit breakers, they are protected by circuit breaker. Let us come to this figure only. It will be easier for you to understand. See, circuit breakers are provided in the main circuit. Circuit breakers are provided in the sub-circuit also. So what will happen? Suppose there is some problem in this sub-circuit. If there is problem in the sub-circuit, if the main circuit breaker here trips, then what will happen? These consumers will also not receive the supply. So it is desirable that these circuit breakers should operate at lower current settings. So if the fault occurs here, it will operate and disconnect, and these will remain as usual. So whenever there is a high fault, this only at that point, this main circuit breaker will operate. Only this thing is written here. You go through it, you will understand. What is the third point? When HRC, we have discussed about high rupturing capacity fuse. Okay, when HRC fuses are used, then what will happen? See, in the event of short circuit exceeding the breaking capacity of the circuit breaker, the HRC fuse should operate first. Okay, so whenever there is severe short circuit, then this high rupturing capacity should operate earlier than the circuit breaker. But for small overloads, the circuit breakers should operate first. Okay, so you go through it. This is only written here. Now some small one small methodology actually to determine the feeder for determining the feeder size for motor connection. Medium size motor connection means 415 three phase four wire supply. So medium voltage motor connection, though this is not very clear, but you can read all these things. These are some rules, Indian electric rules are given. So you go through it. That means each motor circuit should be protected by separate fuses, and these fuses should be rated to 150%. Why 150%? Because at starting, this motor current is very high with respect to the full load current. So in order to, so that it can withstand the starting current, the rating is kept like this. Okay, and starter should be provided. Okay, for starting the motor. And ironclad switch should be there. You know what is ironclad switch, you have operated that. Okay, now how to choose the feeder size? For that, H is considered as the horsepower of the motor. This is actually small n, efficiency of the motor. The IL means line current, IS is the starting current. One thing you do, you make a note in your copy, then you will find everything is understandable. You can understand all these terms. VT is the line voltage, cos theta is power factor, D is the diameter of the wire, rho is the resistivity of the material. Okay, for copper it is given, and also for aluminum it is given. So you should always remember, though it is not clear, but you know the you should always remember the resistivity of at least copper, aluminum and silver. Okay. Now, what is motor input? Motor input, you know, if it is given in horsepower, you have to multiply by 746 and divide it by your efficiency, because you know the H is the output power of the motor. So you can easily get the input power. Okay, so from the input power, actually, say input power is W. So what is the full load current? It is simply W by V for DC. And if it is three phases of supply, it will be W by root 3 V cos theta, VT cos theta, or VL cos theta, whatever you write. Okay, so you can find out what is the full load current. Okay, actually this is the full load current. And the starting current, I have told you, normally the starting current is 150%, but for safety purpose, it is given as 200%. So starting current is considered as 200% of the motor full load current. Okay. According to IE rules, the maximum permissible voltage drop during starting of the motor is 7.5% of the declared supply voltage. So you have to design in such a way that during starting, you know, that is voltage dip when you start a motor, but that voltage drop should not be more than 7.5% of the declared supplied voltage. Okay, declared supply voltage. Now, for motors operating from DC supply, okay, what is the resistance? Resistance means I into R, that is the voltage drop of the motor. Okay, I during the starting, so we will consider the starting voltage drop at the starting. So it should be IS into R will be 7.5% of V. Okay, just it is written. So R is this one. So from here, that is, and this is the resistance of the go and return wire of the feeder. Okay, because the voltage drop should not be more than 7.075 of the rated voltage. Now, what is the resistance of the feeder? If the length of the feeder is L, you have to consider both the go and return wire. So the total resistance is rho twice L by A. Okay. So this is one resistance calculated from the diameter of the feeder. This is the resistance calculated from the maximum permissible voltage drop. Okay. So now we equate these two, and A, you know, it is pi d square by 4. We can find out the diameter of the feeder. Just equating these two, the diameter, just this one you make, this one to be equal to this one, and the expression for diameter you can get like this. Okay. So this is for DC, okay? Because DC only you can get V by I into R equal to this one. And for AC, what will happen? because in VC, in DC, VL is VL, only one voltage is there. But for AC, the voltage will be line voltage by root 3, because you have to consider for per phase on per phase basis. Everything will remain same, but this VL, you have to calculate on per phase basis. So it is VL by root 3, 1.73. The other things are exactly same. Okay, you look at these two and you find out this value. Now, whatever resistance or whatever diameter you have obtained from here, from the maximum permissible voltage drop, you have to check with two other criteria. What are those criteria? One is the overrating consideration or the maximum permissible current density. Okay, you have to check whether that diameter is sufficient for diameter of the feeder is sufficient for the maximum to carry that current. Okay, so from the permissible current density, okay, the permissible current density is provided 160 ampere per square centimeter for copper, 100 ampere per square centimeter for aluminum conductor. You know, current density is I by area. Current density I by area. So actually I by this pi d square by 4 should be equal to C. C means these values. So you have to check whether it is exceeding this value. You have to check IL by pi d square by 4. IL you have calculated from here. IS you have calculated from here. Now you calculate what is the current density. I by pi d square by 4. And it should be within this maximum current density. Okay, you have to check. So it is written here, cross check. One is maximum permissible current density. Another thing you have to check for the maximum mechanical strength. Okay, mechanical strength, the safe cross sectional area should be, it is given for 1.5 millimeter square for copper conductor, 2.5 millimeter square for aluminum conductor. You have to check whether these feeder size is, are having sufficient mechanical strength also. Okay, or one thing what they have done, they have calculated separately. 1D they have calculated from the maximum permissible voltage drop, and another D they have calculated from the maximum permissible current density, another D they have calculated from the mechanical strength. Okay, that should be provided. So three diameters they are obtained, D, D1 and D2, and whatever the largest one, the diameter they have chosen, and the largest diameter should be considered. If the, you consider the largest diameter, then all of these criteria should be satisfied. So final value for the diameter of feeder wire will be the largest of D, D1 and D2. Okay, again this largest diameter should be compared with this ASWG chart, standard wire gauge chart. You know, whatever diameter you calculate that is not readily available in the market. So you have to compare it with that chart. So what are the what are available in the market, that will be shown in that chart. And you have to select the gauge number, number of strands, etc. Usually above calculated diameter will lie between two standard gauge numbers. It will not match any, it may not match with any number. It may lie in between two numbers. The lower gauge number corresponding to larger diameter should be adopted. Okay, this is a rule for selection of feeder size for the conductor. Now, is it okay, all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
So actually, these are very simple things, common things. And I think I have covered your syllabus. Only one thing is left, that is before giving a supply or switching on the supply in any domestic installation, some checking must be done. Okay, that, like whether the earth wire is okay or not, and whether the voltage drop is okay, and some checking should be done. Three or four checkings are there that I have not discussed, and I think it will be sufficient if I provide some notes on that. So I think I have covered everything other than that. If I require any class I will tell you, otherwise I won't take any class. I will inform you if I take any more classes, and otherwise I will give you one note on that. And it is also very simple. If you go through it, you can easily understand. Okay, so I will provide these notes, and you have to study. It is not like that you will just go through my notes and you will understand everything. Unless you read some books, you won't be able to have the idea of whatever I have taught you. Okay, do you have any questions?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So, from next Tuesday, I won't be taking any class. And if you have any problem, you can contact your CR. And I will, if you need any, or you need to discuss anything, or you need to arrange any class, the CR should contact me. I will arrange further classes. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
So thank you, all of you.